who was born as you mentioned many times, 631 of the Hijrah, and passed away 676. Huh? The Facebook one?
Yeah,
what
the Facebook? Facebook page.
No, this. Yeah, maybe it needs time, just you can refresh. So right away we start inshallah with the we continue with the book of Al-Adhkar by Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah. And we reached the hadith. We are still talking about the last introductory chapter, or you can say the first chapter of the dhikr in this book, which in which he mentions what? Selection of a hadith about dhikr which is not restricted to a certain time or a certain condition. So he's talking about the merits of dhikr in general and the rewards of dhikr and the merits of dhikr and the fadl of dhikr in general. He says, وَرَوَيْنَا فِي صَحِيحِ مُسْلِمْ أَيْضًا عَنْ أَبِي هُرَيْرَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ قَالْ. He says, we have narrated in the book of Imam Muslim, which is Sahih Muslim, also from Abu Hurairah رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ قَالْ. And as we mentioned, he says, رَوَيْنَا فِي صَحِيحِ مُسْلِمْ means he narrated through his sheikhs. قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ لَأَنْ أَقُولَ سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر أحب إلي مما طلعت عليه الشمس. He is saying صلى الله عليه وسلم, if I say سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر, that is dearer to me and more beloved by me than all that on which the sun has risen. Means what? The whole world. It's more beloved to me and dearer to me than the whole world. Just these words, Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wala ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. Why? Because the whole world will perish. The whole world will go. But these words will remain. And these words are al-baqiyat al-salihat in some of the tafasir. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Surah Al-Kahf, al-malu wal-banuna zinatul hayati al-dunya wal-baqiyat al-salihatu khayrun inda rabbika thawaban wa khayrun amala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says Surah Al-Kahf, chapter 18, وَالْبَاقِيَاتُ الصَّالِحَاتُ خَيْرٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ ثَوَابًا وَخَيْرٌ أَمْلًا. Surah Al-Kahf, chapter 18, ayah 46, ayah 46, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that money and children are the decoration and the ornament of this worldly life. But al-baqiyat al-salihat, the good ones that will remain are better with your Lord or in the sight of your Lord, and better in reward, and they give you the hope in getting those rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and giving you the hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy and qualify you to get the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these words, or al-baqiyat al-salihat in some of the hadith, they are interpreted as these words. Those good ones that will remain are these words. Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. We explained these words before in details. Subhanallah means what? Means unazzihu Allah an kulli ma la yaliqu bihi, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Means I negate all types of imperfection, I negate them from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Means I acknowledge and I admit and I declare that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beyond and above any imperfection of any type, above any flaw, above any deficiency. That is subhanallah. Usabbihu subhanallah. That is the meaning of subhanallah. Alhamdulillah means all praise and thanks be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For so I praise Allah. Alhamdulillah means I praise Him. What for? For His attributes, because He deserves the praise, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he deserves all praise. Why? Because he has all perfection qualities. And he's free from all imperfection qualities, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa la ilaha illallah, this is kalimatul tawheed. Or they call it al-kalima. Just when they say al-kalima, this means la ilaha illallah. And it is the greatest dhikr, as we will mention inshallah next time, when Imam Nawawi mentions the hadith about la ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. Al-ilah in Arabic has many meanings. Ilah min aliha ya'lahu. Ya'ni abada ya'budu. So al-ilah means the worshipped one. Means the one who deserves the worship, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So no one deserves the worship except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. La ilaha illallah. No one deserves the worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also al-ilah from waliha, which means adorned, means loved so much to the extent he is amazed. That's also waliha. So al-ilah, this in this sense, it will mean the one who amazes the heart, the hearts, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we heard from our Shaykh, like, هو الذي تولهت القلوب بمحبته وتحيرت العقول بعظمته. Because also ilah, it comes from aliha or alaha, which means تحيرا, that he's confused, he's so amazed that he's like shocked or amazed by what? He's in full awe, in full astonishment. Why? Because of the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his greatness, his majesty, it amazes the minds. So he's الَّذِي تَوَلَّهَتِ الْقُلُوبُ بِمَحَبَّتِهِ, the one who's the one in him, in him the hearts are amazed, subhanahu wa ta'ala, adorned him, the hearts adorned him, the hearts loved him so much, and the minds are shocked or are in awe of his greatness and majesty. تولهت القلوب بمحبته وتحيرت العقول بعظمته سبحانه وتعالى. Also, ilah is the one that you resort to and you find comfort in. They say that the camel or the baby camel alihat ila ummiha or alihat al-naqa means it resorted to its mother. So the one that you find comfort in is al-ilah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You find comfort, you find consolation, you find tranquility. تَسْكُنُ إِلَيْهِ تَأَلَّهَ أَلِهَا إِلَيْهِ also سَكَنَ إِلَيْهِ. You find peace with him, you find tranquility with him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even the word Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes from the, according to many scholars, from the word ilah. The word Allah means al-ilah. The word Allah itself means al-ilah. Al-ilah means al-ma'luh, means al-ma'bud or al-mutawallah bi-mahabbatihi. Man al-mafzu'u ilayhi, al-mahbub, shiddat al-hub, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah means love. Allah is the God of love, subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that you find, the one that you love so much, and the one that you find peace in, and the one that you find comfort in, and the one that you worship, subhanahu wa ta'ala. La ilaha illallah. All these meanings are included in this sentence. La ilaha illallah. Wallahu akbar. Allah is greater than everything, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the creator of everything and he controls everything and he is greater than everything, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these words our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, هلا مشي الحال هيك شفت هذا. He's saying sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these words are dearer to me than the whole world. أحب إلي من مما طلعت عليه الشمس. الله أكبر. Imam al-Qurtubi radiallahu anhu, he's saying, بارك الله فيك. هاي الأخ عم يخبرنا أنه so بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله تمام هيك إن شاء الله اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين جزاكم الله خير يا شيخ so أحب إلي مما طلعت عليه الشمس These words سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر أحب إلي مما طلعت عليه الشمس Imam al-Qurtubi, he has nice words here. He's saying, this is for exaggeration. Why? Because the dunya, this worldly life, is not equal to a wing of a mosquito in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. الدنيا لا تساوي عند الله جناحة بعوضة. So it's obvious for the prophets عليهم الصلاة والسلام that these words of dhikr are greater and incomparable to the whole world. So what does that mean? So he's saying the possible meaning is that these adhkar, to say them is better for me and dearer to me than having the whole world and spending it in the good causes. Tamam? Having or saying these words is dearer to me than having the whole world and spending it for the good causes. Subhanallah. Then he says, Rahimahullah Imam al-Nawawi, وَرَوَيْنَا فِي صَحِيحَيِّ الْبُخَارِيِّ وَمُسْلِمِ Or we'll keep this hadith for the next time, inshallah. So let's take just one hadith so that we can give the other topic it's a little bit more time. Now we will move to the adhkar that we stopped at, which is what? Who remembers what was the last dhikr we stopped at? Bismillah alladhi la ilaha illahu. Barakallahu fi. When do you say that? When you put off your clothes, right? When you take off your clothes and you want to put them away, you say this so that you will be protected from the jinn and so that they will not look at you, right? When you take off your clothes. Now the next dhikr is باب ما يقول إذا خرج من منزله. The dhikr on or the section on what he says or what you say when you leave your house. So as we mentioned, Imam al-Nawawi radiallahu anhu, he's like trying to go in a chronological order. Like he started with the evening adhkar, then in the morning when you wake up, then now you're gonna go out. You're not gonna stay home all the time, right? And people who stay home all the time, like the lazy ones, they're not loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah, لا يحب العبد البطال, right? Allah does not love those who are jobless or they just stay home all the time, right? No, you have to go out and seek your provision, and the one who seeks his provision and works and earns by his own hands is better and more loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the one who doesn't. Right? Inna Dawood al-Nabi kana ya'kulu min amali yadih. That Sayyidina Dawood alayhi salam, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam tells us, that he used to eat from what he earns. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Mulk, هو الذي جعل لكم الأرض ذلولا فامسوا في مناكبها وكلوا من رزقه وإليه النشور. He's the one who made the earth submissive or submitting to you. هو الذي جعل لكم الأرض ذلولا فامسوا في مناكبها. So go away and walk in its ways. وكلوا من رزقه and eat from his provision and seek his sustenance. سبحانه وتعالى. And remember وإليه النشور. Remember that don't get drowned in the worldly life. Don't get drowned in your job and these things. No. Remember وإليه النشور. To him is the resurrection, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what do you say when you leave your house? He says, Imam al-Nawawi radiyallahu anhu, رَوَيْنَا عَنْ أُمِّ سَلَمَةَ رَضِيَ عَنْهَا وَاسْمُهَا هِنْدْ He says, we have narrated from Salama radiyallahu anha. Who's Salama? Our mother radiyallahu anha, one of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, her name is Hind. Her name was Hind radiyallahu anha. He said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kana idha kharaja min baytihi qal bismillah tawakkaltu ala Allah. اللهم إني أعوذ بك أن أضل أو أضل أو أزل أو أزل أو أظلم أو أظلم أو أجهل أو يجهل علي. حديث صحيح رواه أبو داود والترمذي والنسائي وابن ماجه. قال الترمذي حديث صحيح هكذا في رواية أبي داود أن أضل أو أضل أو أزل أو أزل وكذا الباقي بلفظ التوحيد. وفي رواية الترمذي أعوذ بك بلفظ التوحيد means يعني أن أضل أو أضل أو أزل أو أزل means in the singular form. وفي رواية الترمذي أعوذ بك من أن نزل in the plural form, that we seek refuge with you from falling and making mistakes. وكذلك نضل ونظلم ونجهل بلفظ الجمع in the plural form. وفي رواية أبي داود ما خرج رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من بيتي إلا رفع طرفه إلى السماء فقال اللهم إني أعوذ بك. And he mentions the hadith. Then he says وفي رواية غيره كان إذا خرج من بيته قال كما ذكرناه والله أعلم. So he says رحمه الله إمام النووي that he narrated from Sayyidina Salama radiyallahu anha, and her name was Hind, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he leaves his house, he would say, Bismillah, in the name of Allah. I seek Allah's help. I seek Allah's blessings. Tawakkaltu ala Allah. I put my trust in Allah. I rely on Allah. Is this a correct translation? To rely on Allah? Depend on Allah. I depend on him. I put my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma means, oh Allah, ya Allah. Allahumma means, ya Allah. Allahumma, inni a'udhu bika, I seek refuge with you from an adil or udal, from deviating or being deviated, from falling astray or being misled by others. And in another narration, adilla aw udilla, from going astray or leading others astray. Both narrations, both meanings. So this is the first meaning. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika, the first sentence. I seek refuge with you. I seek your protection, ya Allah. I am now going out. I will interact with people. There will be now transactions. Shayateen are there. Whether shayateen from the humans or shayateen from the jinn, there will be temptations, there will be tests, there will be trials, there will be interaction with people, someone might offend you, someone might mock you, someone. So this is life, fitna. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجَعَلْنَا بَعْضَكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ فِتْنَةً أَتَصْبِرُونَ وَجَعَلْنَا بَعْضَكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ فِتْنَةً أَتَصْبِرُونَ. Amazing ayah, surah الإسراء. وجعلنا بعضكم لبعض فتنة أتصبرون. سورة الفرقان. وجعلنا بعضكم لبعض فتنة. 25-20, the last part of the ayah, very nice part of the ayah. وجعلنا بعضكم لبعض فتنة أتصبرون وكان ربك بصيرا. We have made some of you as a test and a trial for some others. Then he said subhanahu wa ta'ala, أتصبرون, will you show patience? Every day we have new people that we are tested with, right? New decisions, new bills, right? New crazy things. You have to show patience. And showing patience does not mean خلاص, you just sit without doing anything. No. Patience, you believe that this is, you don't object on Allah's decree. You believe this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed to happen, but you should act. If this is something wrong, you should act. أتصبرون وكان ربك بصيرا. And your Lord is all seeing, means He knows who will show patience and who will not, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who will act and who will not. So أعوذ بك أن أضل أو أضل. Once you leave the house, remember and seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's protection. I seek refuge with you from falling astray or being misled by others. Excuse me. Or misleading others. أو أزل أو أزل or to fall and أزل or أو أزل or to cause to be to fall by others means to make mistakes or sins by myself or to be pushed and seduced by others to make those sins or those mistakes. Tamam? Is this close to what you have, Ya Sheikh? أو أظلم أو أظلم or to wrong others or to be wronged by others. To face injustice or to show and do injustice to others. To be oppressed or to oppress others. Oh Allah, I seek refuge with you from this. And there's a very nice hadith also from the Adhkar of the morning. It will come later, but I'll mention it now. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that أَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ شَرِّ نَفْسِي I seek refuge with you from the evil of my soul and وَأَنْ أَقْتَرِفَ عَلَى نَفْسِي سُوءًا أَوْ أَجُرَّهُ إِلَى مُسْلِمٍ And I seek refuge with you from wronging myself or causing evil or wrong to a Muslim. Okay? And of course, this hadith here is general. Not only, it doesn't mean you are allowed to cause harm to non-Muslims. Muslims are not allowed to cause harm to any person, and not only people, even to creatures. Even creatures, you are not allowed to cause harm to them. You are not allowed to cause harm to trees and plants. You are not allowed to cause harm to cats and dogs. Right? You're not allowed to harm any creature. This is the teachings of Islam. And still some people, subhanAllah, they want to ignore all of these facts and they want to just generalize on over all Muslims just because of few people who do not make any percentage in the total Muslim population of the world. Anyway, we have to work hard so that we show people who we truly are. أو أظلم أو أظلم أو أجهل أو يجهل علي الجهل means الحمق وال أن أجهل أو يجهل علي means to show ignorance means to reply on those who will show me bad morals to reply on them with bad actions with bad replies to lose your temper as they say right To lose your control. That's al-jahl. And this is why Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إذا كان صوم يوم أحدكم فلا يرفث ولا يفسق ولا يجهل ولا يجهل. So don't lose your temper and don't reply those who show you bad morals with bad morals. Right? أو أجهل أو يجهل علي. That I... Show ignorance, I lose my temper against others, I say bad words to others, or it is being said to me. I seek refuge with you from both things. How they translated this sentence, أو أجهل أو يجهل علي?
From acting ignorantly, or others acting ignorantly towards me.
Mm-hmm. Acting ignorantly, and particularly speaking also. It's more about speaking. Okay. He said this is an authentic hadith narrated by Imam Abu Dawud and others. And as we mentioned, in some narrations like in Imam Tirmidhi's narration, it is in the plural form. So you're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect you from you and your family or you and the Muslims from misguidance, from wrong, from oppression, etc.
So what's the link between ignorance and anger?
Because when they intimidate you, they will make you get angry, so you will act ignorantly. Right? And this is why he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith about fasting, because this word is used there, that if someone says bad words to you when you're fasting, right? فإن شتمه أحد أو ساببه if someone calls you names or insults you or whatever then you say إني صائم say I'm fasting okay you don't reply to them you don't lose your temper you don't show you don't respond with ignorant or act with ignorance. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. There is a hadith, another hadith. إذا كان أحدكم صائما فلا يرفث ولا يجهل, right? And here is another hadith in which he is saying, صلى الله عليه وسلم, this is in Sunan Nasa'i, الصيام جنة من النار. صيام, fasting, is protection from the fire. So whoever wakes up in the morning and he's fasting, فلا يجهل يومئذ, don't act ignorantly or say words of ignorance. وَإِنِ امْرُؤٌ جَهِلَ عَلَيْهِ, if a person showed ignorance to you, means acted ignorantly, said words, bad words to you, فَلَا يَشْتِمْهُ وَلَا يَسُبَّهُ, don't insult him, don't call him names, and say, I am fasting. Tamam? So he wants you, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to respond with good and to repel evil with good. In the narration of Imam Abu Dawood, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he leaves the house, he would raise his hands to the he would raise his head to the heaven, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he will make this dua. Okay? He will raise his head to the heaven, Allahumma. And there are many texts in the Quran and the Sunnah that indicate that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in the highness, or in as-sama, which means in the highness, means he is in the highest status and rank, subhanahu wa ta'ala. عُلُوُّ الْمَكَانَةِ وَالْقَهْرِ, عُلُوُّ الْمَكَانَةِ وَالْقَهْرِ, it is the highness of greatness and majesty and position and rank, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, and also, another also meaning that, like Imam An-Nawawi mentioned and others, that when you make the dua, sometimes you look up, because the heaven or the sky is the qibla of the dua, just as the Kaaba is the qibla of salah. When you make salah, you cannot look up. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbade us, when you do salah, when you perform your prayer, the ritual prayer, to look up to the heaven, to the sky. Where should you look? Your body and your face should be directed towards the Kaaba, right? In Mecca. And your heart should be directed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And this qibla, which is the physical qibla, the qibla of your body, which is the Kaaba, you can abandon, you can compromise it sometimes. I mean, sometimes you can pray without directing your body towards the Kaaba. Like what? Like you're praying voluntary prayer, sunnah. You can pray in the car, even if your car directing opposite of the direction of the Kaaba. But the qibla of the heart, the direction of the heart, should always be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tamam? Now, Imam An-Nawawi radiallahu anhu said in the hadith about the one that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked here about Allah, he said that the sky is the qibla of dua. The sky is the qibla of dua. So the one that when people want to ask him subhanahu wa ta'ala, they raise their hands towards the heaven, because the heaven is the qibla, or the direction for the dua. It is where the mercy comes from, where the blessings come from. Tamam? So that's another narration. And the final hadith here, he says, وَرَوَيْنَا فِي سُنَنِ أَبِي دَاوُودِ, or let me stop here, let's move to the main topic. So we'll continue, there are two more ahadith in this section, what to say when you leave the house. So we'll take just this one, inshallah, for today. So, اللهم, what do we say? بسم الله توكلت على الله, اللهم إني أعوذ بك أن أضل وضل. Tamam. Bismillah, tawakkaltu ala Allah. You can say la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. It's coming in the next hadith, inshallah, next time. So the narration that we got today, Bismillah, tawakkaltu ala Allah. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an adilla aw udal, aw azilla aw uzal, أو أظلم أو أظلم أو أجهل أو يجهل علي. تمام؟ بسم الله توكلت على الله. اللهم إني أعوذ بك أن أضل أو أضل أو أزل أو أزل أو أظلم أو أظلم أو أجهل أو يجهل علي. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of the dhakirin, make us of those who stick to his remembrance and stick to his dhikr subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mashi. Today, inshallah, in the story of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, we're wrapping up the story of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam. And we will mention today, inshallah, some of the ways and the tricks of Shaytan and some of the things that the Shaytan does so that he will mislead others and so that he will lead others to their destruction. And we will start with a hadith from our beloved sallallahu alayhi wasallam, narrated by Imam al-Tirmidhi and others. He said sallallahu alayhi wasallam, or it's narrated that he said, inna lish shaytani lammatan. إِنَّ لِلشَّيْطَانِ لَمَّةً بِبْنِ آدَمِ إِنَّ لِلشَّيْطَانِ لَمَّةً بِبْنِ آدَمِ وَلِلْمَلَكِ لَمَّةً. Surely the shaytan has lamma with the child of Adam. And lamma means like he has a type of approach, he has a chance or a way that he will be close to the child of Adam. And what will he will do in that approach or that, whispering, we will see now in the hadith. And also the angel has also lamma. Also the angel has like a chance to say something to the child of Adam. فَأَمَّا لَمَّةُ الشَّيْطَانِ. As for the lamma of the shaytan, فَإِعَادٌ بِالشَّرِّ وَتَكْذِيبٌ بِالْحَقِّ. As for the shaytan, he is evil to you. And he tries to lead you to the evil, to what is wrong, to what is false. وَتَكْذِيبٌ بِالْحَقِّ. And it leads you to disbelieve in the truth, and to reject the truth, and to deny the truth, to deny the belief. وَأَمَّا لَمَّةُ الْمَلَكِ. As for the lamma of the malak, فَإِعَادٌ بِالْخَيْرِ وَتَصْدِيقٌ بِالْحَقِّ. As for the malak, he inspires you with good. Means he guides you or tells you to do good. وَتَصْدِيقٌ بِالْحَقِّ. And to believe in the truth, and to follow the truth, and to stay on the truth. فَمَنْ وَجَدَ ذَلِكَ فَلْيَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ مِنَ اللَّهِ. So whoever finds this, means what? لَمَّةِ الْمَلَك. Excuse me, لَمَّةِ الْمَلَك. If you find this, that telling you to do good and to believe in the truth and these good things, then you know that this is from Allah. So you should فَلْيَحْمَدِ اللَّهِ. فَلْيَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ مِنَ اللَّهِ فَلْيَحْمَدِ اللَّهِ. وَمَنْ وَجَدَ الْأُخْرَى فَلْيَتَعَوَّذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. And whoever finds the other one, then he should seek refuge with Allah from the shaytan, from the cursed shaytan. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam read the ayah, الشَّيْطَانُ يَعِدُكُمُ الْفَقْرُ وَيَأْمُرُكُمْ بِالْفَحْشَاءِ. The shaytan promises you or guides you or tries to lead you to poverty and need. And he commands you with vice. He commands you to do vice and he commands you to be miserly on yourselves. That's the hadith that we would like to start with. So as just like the shaytan has whisperings, also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the angels, the malaika, also they make ilham. They remind us and they try to also to guide us and to lead us to the good. And Mulla Ali al-Qari, rahimahullah, in his commentary on this hadith, he mentions something very nice. He's saying, in order to know these khawatir, these ideas that come to you, or these internal calls, if you like, these internal calls, to distinguish between them and to be able to know whether these are from shaitan or from angels, the details and the knowledge of this is in the books of the of the people of tasawwuf, the Sufi scholars. Why? Because they are the ones who are specialized about the heart and about the soul and about these topics and about spirituality and about these things. And Imam al-Ghazali, rahimahullah, he mentions and clarifies this in one of his books. And he says, Mulla Ali al-Qari, that the scholars agreed or the sheikhs agreed that whoever earns haram, whoever has his income is from haram sources, then he will not be able to distinguish between waswasa and ilham. He will not be able to distinguish between the whisperings of the shaitan and the inspiration of the angels. It will be mixed for him. So sometimes the shaitan tells you to do something which apparently looks good, but it is not. Apparently it looks good, but it is not good. So you need to have the pure heart so that you'll be able to distinguish and to know what is a whispering from shaitan and what is an inspiration from the angel. Even Imam al-Daqaq, al-Ustadh al-Daqaq, also one of the great spiritual field scholars, he says that whoever does not have full trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he will also not be able to distinguish between them. And he says, Mulla Ali al-Qardi, this inspiration is not reliable in regard with the shari'i rulings. Is not reliable as a source of legislation. But it is reliable in knowing the whispers of the self and the whispers of the shaitan. Tamam? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam here is drawing our attention that we have, as we have the shayateen who try to mislead us, we also have the malaika who also tries to help us, right? And the shaitan also, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, فَلْيَتَعَوَّذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ, when you find those whisperings, seek Allah's protection. So remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who controls shaitan. Shaitan has no control over the true servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Surah Al-Hijr, Ayah 42, إِنَّ عِبَادِي لَيْسَ لَكَ عَلَيْهِمْ سُلْطَانِ, you have no control over my true servants. Who is this addressed to? Shaitan. إِنَّ لَيْسَ لَكَ عَلَيْهِمْ سُلْطَانِ, you have no power over my true servants. Right? There are many benefits also in this hadith, but that will be enough inshallah. So let's go very quickly to 10 of the main ways of shaitan in which he tries to mislead us and to decorate things for us. Of course, the shaitan will not come to us in a direct way and tell us to do something wrong in a direct way. The shaitan has its ways. He has deceit, he has decoration, he has many ways so that he will make you fall in the sin. Sometimes you are unaware, right? So he has a lot of steps, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned us from him, and he said, Surah An-Nur, ayah 21, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu la tattabi'u khutuwati shaytan. O you who believe, do not follow the footsteps of shaytan, or the steps of shaytan. Don't follow the ways that will lead you to what the shaitan is planning for you. And every sin is of those steps of the shaitan. First way of shaitan is decoration. Tazyeen. Tazyeen. And he said this clearly, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about shaitan. Surah Al-Hijr, Ayah 15. Surah Al-Hijr, which is chapter 15. And ayah 39 and ayah 40. قال ربي بما أغويتني لأزينن لهم في الأرض ولأغوينهم أجمعين إلا عبادك منهم المخلصين. Shaytan said after he disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, O Lord, he knows Allah is his Lord. He said, O Lord, since you misled me, he's accusing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, since you misled me, I will decorate for them on the earth. Decoration. He will decorate things. He will make ugly things appear beautiful so that he will attract you. وَلَأُغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ And I will lead all of them astray. إِلَّا عِبَادَكَ مِنْهُمُ الْمُخْلَصِينَ Except for the sincere ones among your servants. I will surely make straying from the right path appear beautiful to them on the earth. And I will make wrong or fair, I will make wrong fair seeming to them. I will make the wrong appear good to them on the earth. Right? So tazyin is one of the main ways of shaitan. How he makes tazyin? Something is wrong, he makes it look very good. Something is good, he makes it look very wrong. Right? So he will not come to you right away. Right? You're sleeping, especially in these cold nights, and it's the adhan time and you're hearing the alarm, so he will start decorating for you the goods, the sleep, and now it's very comfortable, now it's very warm here, outside is very cold, right? You don't have to, the masjid is far, this, so he'll start decorating. Decorating this thing which is wrong, he start making it appear good to you, right? And something is good, he will start making it appear as wrong or as dangerous, right? You want to go, then he'll start telling you now, it might be raining, it might be this, it might be, now you might get cold. He starts like bringing and trying to decorate things for you so that he will push you away. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَزَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَعْمَالَهُمْ فَصَدَّهُمْ عَنِ السَّبِيلِ The shaitan decorated their actions for them, so he pushed them away from the way. So this is the first one. The other one is talbis, which is like khida, which is deceit, deceiving the believer. أعطي شاي. حط له شاي. صب له شاي لإلياس. صب له شاي. بسم الله. Deceit is what he tries to convince you that what is haram is halal and what is halal is haram. Tamam? He tries to convince you and deceive you that you are, for example, in need, you are poor, so he starts decorating to you that, well, this person has so much money, he has so much, he doesn't need money, so he starts decorating for you and try to convince you that you can take something from him, you can take, you are working, you say, this is a person, he has a large store, right, he has a large shop, just I can take something, I'm in need, so he might bring to you some, he's a non-Muslim, it's okay, these are non-Muslims, right? You can take, their money is okay, right? We are in non-Muslim country, yeah, this is some Muslims, they say, it's okay, you can sell them alcohol, no problem. You are not selling it to Muslims, we are in our non-Muslim country, there are some scholars who mention this, right? And there are no scholars who mention this in this, their words are not in this context at all. But this is how some people take it when they want to fulfill their desires. This is how the shaitan decorates for them. That it's okay. They drink, so you can sell them alcohol. But if you ask those brothers, okay, what if someone, whenever someone comes, you will just suppose this is a correct ruling, which is not, for no doubt for me. Suppose they want to apply this ruling, then every person who will come, every customer, you will tell him, are you Muslim? Or now some people, they don't look, you don't know whether they're Muslims or not. So you will ask them, you will ask every person who comes, you will dare not ask them. Subhanallah, but some Muslims, this is how they fell in this trap. They fell in this trap. And I said many times, and I said to some brothers, that this is a double sin. This is a double sin. It is not only impermissible, but it is also double sin. Because number one, you are selling them something that is harmful to them. And number two, you are distorting the picture of Islam and Muslims in their eyes. Right? Everyone knows, this is the Muslim, that gas station, it's owned by a Muslim guy, right? That store, the whatever store, it's the Muslim guy. The tobacco store, that's the Muslim guy, right? So it's, mashallah, you have made, what a reputation you have made about Islam and Muslims. What a reputation you have made. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yani guide all of our brothers who fell in this trap of Shaytan. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help them to get better places, better jobs, inshallah. So number three, tasweef. This is very common, which is what? Procrastination. Shaytan always tells you, why you're in a hurry? Why you're in a hurry? There is time. Life is long. Still, you are still young. You're still very young. You can do. Right? So, procrastination. Why you, now you have to go? Why you, you want to do this now? You can do it later. Still, we have time. So, he keeps whispering to you, why you wake up now? Still, it's 3 hours. Half an hour. Still half an hour. It's plenty of time. Then you find, 15 minutes. Yalla, you don't need 15 minutes. In 5 minutes, you can just make wudu and go. Then 5 minutes, until I go, then it will be gone. Khalas. Then he just got you. So procrastination. That's one of the very, very common ways of Shaytan. Very common ways. He just wants you to leave things. Don't do it. Yalla, later. I'm going to do it later. Let me just watch this. Let me just see this this video. Let me, from here to here, you find that the time we wasted. How much of our lives we wasted. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala awaken us to the traps of Shaytan. Procrastination is one of the very common ways that Shaytan really took over many people by procrastination. Leave it. You can do it later. Let's do it later. Inshallah, next year I'm gonna start coming to the halqa. Inshallah, next year. Inshallah, next year I'm gonna start learning how to recite the Quran. This is now. There's pressure in the job, so I'm gonna start next time. I'm gonna start from tomorrow. I'm gonna start next month, from the beginning of the year. So always, he tries as if you guarantee that you will live long. As if you guarantee, subhanallah. And you don't even guarantee your breath. That's number three. Number four, tahweenul ma'asiyah. Making you belittle the sin. What have we done, ya akhi? If he does something wrong, he does a sin, he says, what have we done? I have not done any, that's not a big thing. Don't make it... Don't be extremist. Don't make it a big issue. Right? Look at other people, what they're doing. Right? This is, so he, Shaytan, tries to, after decorating the sin for you, making you procrastinate, deceiving you, then you fall in the sin. After you fall in the sin, he wants you to belittle the sin. Look down upon look down at it. Means, it's not a big issue, ya akhi. I have not done anything big. Look at people, other people, they are drinking and they are doing this. And I have not done, it's just a movie. It's just like, it's just a look, it's just a touch. Some people are doing more, right? It's just a smile, it's just. That's how Shaytan tries to make the sin look small and insignificant in front, in your eyes. And the great scholars of Tasawwuf, they say, لا تنظر إلى صغر الذنب ولكن انظر من عصيت. Don't look at the sin, that this is a big sin or a small sin, but look and reflect and remember who is the one that you disobeyed by making this sin. لا تنظر إلى صغر الذنب ولكن انظر من عصيت. الله أكبر. So for the believer and the heart of the believer, even the small sin is big. Even this is for the normal believer. For the awliya, if they leave a sunnah, for them that's a sin. If they leave a preferable act, which is not obligatory act, for them that's a sin. If they wake up at Fajr time, that's for them a sin. That's the awliya. Those are the close ones of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the more you ascend in the levels and the stations of closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more you have awe and respect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the small thing that is for others is maybe a great thing to reach, for you it will be a very wrong thing, right? Like for the normal Muslim, if he wakes up for Fajr on time, that's a great thing for him, for the normal Muslim. But for the Salihin, the righteous ones, those who are ascending in their relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if they wake up at Fajr, they feel as if they made a sin, wallahi. They say, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Look, Fajr has just entered. We lost Qiyam al-Layl, we lost the chance to pray before Fajr. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. So that's the way of Shaytan, making the sin look insignificant for you. This means what? You will make another sin and a third sin, and you just keep making sins. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he warned us in a very nice hadith. He said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I think we mentioned this hadith maybe 1 year ago. إياكم ومحقرات الذنوب. إياكم ومحقرات الذنوب. Or before this hadith, let me read to you this hadith. In Sahih Bukhari, Sayyidina Anas bin Malik radiyallahu anhu, subhanAllah, look at this hadith that proves the point that I have just mentioned. He said, radiyallahu anhu, the servant of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyidina Anas, he said, إِنَّكُمْ لَتَعْمَلُونَ أَعْمَالًا هِيَ أَدَقُّ فِي أَعْيُونِكُمْ مِنَ الشَّعْرِ كُنَّا نَعُدُّهَا عَلَىٰ أَهْدِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مِنَ الْكَبَائِرِ مِنَ الْمُوبِقَاتِ. يعني المهلكات. You are doing some actions that are in your eyes even thinner than the hair. Means it's very, very little. It's nothing. It's insignificant. But at the time of Rasulullah, you see, the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, those companions, they are in high level. He says, in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, those same things or acts that you think they're thinner than the hair, in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we'll consider them of the destroyers, of the destructive deeds. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. See the meaning that we've just mentioned? The other hadith, he said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إياكم ومحقرات الذنوب فإنهن يجتمعن على الرجل حتى يهلكنه. Beware of the sins that look small, because they gather on the man until they destroy him. They gather on the man until they destroy him. So we have to be very careful from this trick of the shaitan. And subhanAllah, look at yani this order of the shaitan's tricks that we have to be very aware of. He starts decorating, make you procrastinate, deceive you, then he makes you fall, then when you fail, he makes you belittle the sin. We did not do a big thing, right? We did not do a big thing, ya akhi. Look at other people, what they're doing, right? And this hadith, إياكم ومحقرات الذنوب, narrated by Imam Ahmad. Narrated by Imam Ahmad. And he gives a very nice example, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He says the example of those sins that محقرات. محقرات means what? Means الناس يحتقرونها. Means people look down and belittle them. Tamam? People belittle those sins. He's saying, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, beware of those belittled sins. Right, ya Shaykh? Beware of the belittled sins, the sins that people belittle. Means look down on them or consider them that they are small ones. He said they are like people who stopped by a valley and they wanted to cook. So one of them, he brought a small stick. Another one brought a small stick. Small stick, maybe a straw, right? Straw, right? This brought some straws, a small stick with a small stick, until they gathered and they made a fire with which they cooked their food. Just like these small sticks and straws, you gathered them and you made a fire. This is how these small, the sins that you think they're small and you're belittling them, they will gather on you. إِنَّ مُحَقَّرَاتِ الذُّنُوبِ مَتَى يُؤْخَذُ بِهَا صَاحِبُهَا تُهْلِكُهُ. Once they gather on the person, they will destroy him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us.
Ameen.
May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us.
Ameen.
And the scholars, they say, الْإِصْرَارُ عَلَى الصَّغِيرَةِ يَجْعَلُهَا كَبِيرَةِ. Insisting on the small sins, it makes it a big sin, a major sin, right? And they say also, and Imam al-Ghazali radiallahu anhu, he says, whenever you consider this sin big in your sight, then it will be considered little in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and vice versa. If you think, if you belittle the sin that in the sight of Allah, it will be big. If you consider it a big sin, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will consider it a little sin. Tamam. So it's about how you look at the creator subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that you disobeyed. Tamam. And finally they say, لا صغيرة مع الاستغفار. لا صغيرة مع الاستغفار. لا كبيرة مع الاستغفار ولا صغيرة مع الإصرار. لا صغيرة مع الإصرار. If you insist on it, then it's not little anymore, it's a major one. وَلَا كَبِيرَةَ مَعَ الْإِسْتِغْفَارِ. If you have a major sin, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us, then istighfar and tawbah, it will make you, it will, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you, and it will be removed. And this is the fifth, this is the fifth way of shaitan, which is what? After you made the sin, if you belittle it, then you think you don't need to ask Allah for forgiveness, and he will succeed in his job. Khalas, you belittled it. You don't think you need even to ask Allah for forgiveness, right? And this is how the hypocrites, the believer, as the Prophet ﷺ says, that the believer is like, he feels his sins like as if he's sitting at a mountain. إن المؤمن يرى ذنوبه كأنه قاعد تحت جبل يخاف أن يقع عليه. That the believer, he looks at his sins as if he's sitting at the base of a mountain that he's afraid that it will fall upon him. Allahu Akbar. Ha, this is how the believer thinks. This is how the believer thinks. As for the hypocrite, he thinks his sins, they are like flies that come across his nose and he just move them like this. He just points with his hand or moves his hand like this. Subhanallah. That is how the believer look at things, and how the hypocrites or the disobedient ones look at things. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who have full awe and respect and fear from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So shaitan, after he makes you belittle the sin, you think you don't need to ask Allah for forgiveness, If you make a big sin and you realize that a big sin, and by the way, this hadith that I have just mentioned about the sin, about how the believer, it is from Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, it's in al-Bukhari. It is in al-Bukhari. When you know that this is a big sin, and this is the last one, it seems we will not be able to finish all of the ten points I prepared. We'll mention just this one, inshallah, and these five will be enough if we be aware of them. And they're very, very, very important. This fifth point, many Muslims fall into or fell into this trap. They know that they made a big sin. They're not belittling the sin, so the shaitan now comes to them and tell them, khalas, you have done a big sin. There's no way it can be forgiven. So he starts making them feel that tawbah is impossible. That tawbah is impossible. That you have done this so many times. How you want Allah to forgive you? You have done this again and again and again. Khalas, you're not a good person. You will not be able to be on the straight path. He will make istiqamah for him impossible. He will decorate for him and make him feel that it is impossible for him to be straight. It's difficult for him. He's not of the righteous ones. He's not. Then he will start also going with him on the qadar issue, right? Maybe he'll say, "Oh, I am written among the miserable ones. I am not written among the righteous ones. I know this is clear. No, but you don't know." This is what the shaitan is telling you. No one knows but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you are among the righteous ones or not. You need to quit listening to the shaitan, and you need to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No matter what sin you did, what mistake you did, and how many mistakes or sins you did, there is no sin in Islam that is unforgivable. That's the summary of this point. So whatever the shaitan comes to you and tells you, you have done this, you have done this, in Islam, there is no sin that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forgive. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Surely Allah forgives all sins. What does that mean? What does that mean? Means if you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness from any sin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives you. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives all sins. Means if you ask Him for forgiveness, even if you are a disbeliever, if someone is a disbeliever, if someone is